Why is the 12-tone scale so commonly used? If you watch music theory videos to make yourself a better musician, you could consider skipping this one. All you really need to know for the sake of making music is that the 12-tone scale isn't just an arbitrary convention arrived at by chance or the aesthetic whims of one particular culture. It does, to some degree, emerge from the order of the cosmos and evolutionary biology. That is not to say that it is the best or only option. There are certainly plenty of other beautiful tonal systems. And it is not to say that culture has had no effect on its development or its current place in the world. But the 12-tone scale is much more than a cultural accident. If we turned back the clock, it's pretty likely that it would evolve again. This video is about the reasons it evolves, not so much the particular history of that evolution. Don't forget to check the video description for corrections, answers to common questions that might come up, timestamps for the video, and a list of links for further study. First, let's cover some basics. If you have watched my Music Theory Distilled series, or already understand pitch, octaves, intervals, and consonants, you may want to skip to the time shown on screen. Let's say you start playing with two pitches sounding at the same time. We call the distance between two pitches an interval. By sliding one of the pitches upward, you soon reach a magical location where the two pitches seem to dissolve into each other. We label this magic interval the octave. Don't worry about the label. We notice that this combination is consonant, meaning there's nothing jarring or rough sounding about it. It's such a consonant combination that it's hard to tell that there are two pitches present. If we slide the second pitch a little further down, say to this random location, we hear that this new interval is significantly more dissonant. In the octave interval, it so happens that the frequency of the higher pitch is an exact doubling of the frequency of the lower pitch. The next octave up requires another doubling, and so on. The mathematically inclined will notice that this means that the pitch scale we're showing on the screen is not linear, but rather logarithmic with respect to frequency. That's done to match the way humans perceive pitch. You don't have to worry about it if you don't understand it. Just know that pitch changes evenly and intuitively as you move left or right in these diagrams. Instead of using the actual frequency values, we're going to show these as ratios with respect to the frequency of the first pitch. Whatever the bass frequency is, we will show it as 1. So the octave is now shown as 2, meaning it's twice the value of the bass frequency. If we plug 300 Hz into the bass frequency, the octave is twice that, so 600 Hz. Anything we come up with in terms of a tonal system will work regardless of the particular frequency it sits at. So we'll use these simpler numbers to make our life easier. We will call this bass frequency the tonic of the tonal system that we are about to invent. Anytime we come to a note that is outside the bounds of our octave, we can reflect it up or down if desired to keep it within the bounds of the octave. We can get away with this because, as stated, the octave is such a consonant interval that notes an octave apart are, in some sense, the same note. Throughout this video, you'll hear the term scale, which in this context is referring to our tonal system, as opposed to a musical scale that refers to a subset of notes from the tonal system. So, we have the tonic, and we have the octave, and we want to find some notes in between that sound nice. Well, let's just start sliding our pitch around and find the most pleasant spot. Here's one that rings quite nicely. It turns out that just as the octave, being twice the frequency of the tonic, has a clear and simple frequency ratio, so does this note. It is 1.5 times the tonic frequency, alternately written as 3/2. Why do the ratios 2 and 3/2 result in consonant-sounding intervals? It's often pointed out that the combined waveforms of such tones exhibit a regular, clean alignment. But the truth is, scientists aren't exactly sure why such alignment would be perceived as consonant, even though a general association between perceived consonants and simple frequency ratios is quite clear. There's a link in the description to a fascinating paper that discusses the nuances and the current hypotheses about consonants. Unison is the most consonant interval, followed by the octave, followed by the 3/2 ratio, followed by others. So the 3/2 ratio is an extremely consonant combination to our ears. As with the octave, sometimes a non-musician has trouble even hearing a 3/2 interval as two distinct pitches. The general agreement across cultures about which intervals sound most consonant is remarkably universal. If we sweep through the octave searching for consonant intervals, and we test our discoveries with many different listeners, we're likely to arrive at these. It turns out that these are based on simple ratios as well. There are other pitches with simple ratios besides these 6, but these are found to be the most consonant. A given sound that we hear is usually a composite of many frequencies, not a pure tone with only a single frequency. Consider this dynamic graph of me singing ah. On this graph, the horizontal axis shows the various frequencies that are simultaneously present in my voice, and the strength of those frequencies is plotted vertically. Any given frame of this animated graph is a single snapshot in time. I'm singing a G note, and you can see that this lowest peak is at, or well, basically at 98 Hz, which is in fact the frequency of a G note. This lowest peak is called the fundamental, and there are some other notable peaks present in the spectrum, sometimes called overtones. This particular overtone happens to be at twice the frequency of the fundamental note, so it's also a G. This pitch is about 3/2 the value of that. See how 294 Hz is 1.5 times 196 Hz? We can isolate that frequency to make it more audible. Well, that's a provocative discovery, isn't it? I'm only singing a single note, yet embedded in the composite frequencies of my voice, we find the same simple frequency ratios. These kinds of overtones are inherent to many acoustical systems. The sound of a struck wooden bar or the resonance of an air cavity. Some of those overtones are consonant, some are not, depending on the particular physics. Instrument makers often manipulate overtones intentionally. But overtones do show up in natural systems. That is, they can emerge as properties of the physical world without human intervention. Consider this 2003 paper by scientists at the Department of Neurobiology and Center for Cognitive Neuroscience at Duke University. They took thousands of recordings of hundreds of people speaking in English, Farsi, French, German, Hindi, Japanese, Korean, Mandarin Chinese, Spanish, Tamil, and Vietnamese. They sliced each recording up into many short clips, analyzed the frequency spectrum just as we did, and looked for patterns in the overtones. They started at the strongest peak and looked in the first octave above it. That peak often isn't the fundamental frequency, since the human voice usually has a weak fundamental with stronger overtones. This remarkable graph was the result. What they found is a distinct series of peaks that line up with all the consonant ratios, including some other slightly less consonant ratios, almost completing a 12-tone scale. The only interval they didn't find evidence for was in the gap just above the tonic. This demonstrates that, on average, the voices of human speakers tend to include overtones that align with a 12-tone scale, when viewed from the perspective of the strongest peak. The scientists also found that their data exactly predicted the subjective ranking of the consonants of musical intervals. Now, does this mean that we humans have altered our speech sounds because the physics of perception means that these overtones sound nice to us? Or is it just the byproduct of what I discussed earlier, that overtones appear naturally in many acoustical systems, including our voices? The scientists explain that although any standard harmonic series of overtones will generate results that include the simple ratios in the graph, the particular statistical results they obtain depend on the particular frequency filtering that a human vocal tract performs. This is consistent with the idea that these particular ratios become special to us as a species due to our physiology, as opposed to arbitrary cultural convention. That's going to help guide our choices as we develop our tonal system. Turning back to the consonant ratios that we found by trial and error, we're off to a good start. We have a humble pile of notes and a solid motivation for choosing them. But there certainly aren't 12. As we stare at these notes, it may be aesthetically tempting to slot some extra notes into these gaps and say that we're done. But where would we put them exactly? And more to the point, why do we feel that we need them? Why not just stop here? Well, we certainly could. Some cultures found that 5 tones to the octave satisfied their needs. It's not that 5 or 7 notes is insufficient, it's that musicians in many cultures wanted more options for melodic and harmonic expression. So let's seek a tonal system using the following guidelines. Number 1. We want to maximize the number of consonant intervals that occur in the system, and minimize the dissonant intervals. We don't have to eliminate all dissonant intervals, we're just setting a goal of leaning as much towards consonants as we can. Number 2. We don't want notes too close together, and we don't want too many notes overall. Humans are only capable of a certain fidelity in their pitch production and perception. If we violate this guideline, it becomes pretty challenging for the average person to make or enjoy music. Of course, the definitions of too many and too close are flexible, but they're important nonetheless. Number 3. We would prefer gaps to be filled. If a gap exists where a reasonable note could comfortably fit, it would be a great bonus to add it, since it offers more compositional options. Notice that combining this rule and rule number 2 implies that the notes in our system will be roughly evenly spaced. So our current system looks okay by these criteria, except for the gaps, which don't satisfy guideline number 3. How are we going to fill them in? What methodology makes sense to find these notes? If we had the benefit of that scientific study, we could remember that 4 of the remaining 5 slots showed up in human speech, so we could just use those. But even centuries ago, there were other paths that led to those notes. Recall that 3/2 interval. We said that this is the most consonant interval besides unison and the octave. What if we take these notes and go up by a ratio of 3/2 from them, reflecting octaves as needed? Then we repeat that process from these new notes. This fills the gaps nicely. We can then observe that these notes are close to some other semi-consonant simple ratios, so we can bend the notes to fit. This is just one method that generates 12 notes, and there are many others, but they are guided by the same principles. A great feature of this system is that many of the combinations of notes, including combinations that don't involve the tonic, are also very consonant. Historically speaking, the 12 notes weren't arrived at quite like this. Early scales evolved much more gradually. In so-called Western music, they sometimes used chains of the three-halves interval to create seven-note scales, and eventually added the in-between notes as time went on. A lot of the history of the 12-tone scale involved tweaking these intervals in different ways, depending on the trade-offs considered appropriate for the music at hand. So the 12-tone system evolved because it meets a very natural set of criteria. It comfortably accommodates all the most consonant intervals. It fills in the remaining gaps with useful notes that, while a little less consonant, play reasonably nicely with other notes in the system. And overall, it doesn't use too many notes or notes too close to each other. A crucial experiment here is to try to achieve these goals with 11 notes, or 13, and so forth. Whatever you come up with won't cover the consonant intervals as nicely, or will include too many dissonant intervals, or will leave gaps, or will use what most people consider to be too many notes. Again, there are other systems in the world, and some use more than 12 tones, and they have their reasons. Traditions like classical Arabic and Indian music were less concerned with the harmonic combinations of notes and more interested in melodic expression. Different cultures may also be comfortable with more or less notes per octave. Other cultures may learn to appreciate dissonance. The 12-tone system seems to be the functional middle ground agreed on by a large number of people. These 12 tones are not perfectly evenly spaced. One implication is that analogous intervals may not sound good, or at least won't sound consistent with each other. The ratio of this interval is 3/2, equivalent to a factor of 1.5. This analogous interval comes out to 1.48. This isn't a crisis, necessarily, but as musicians started pushing the boundaries of their tonal system and developing a more sophisticated harmony, they started to value systems that allowed them to trust that analogous intervals would sound the same. Meaning, it would be great to have a tonal system that let them play this interval here, or here, or here, and achieve a consistent level of consonance, which would result in more compositional flexibility. A chord of four notes has six intervals inside it. This, 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 and this. If a musician has to consider every one of those pairs of notes as having a distinct character depending on where it occurs in the scale, you can see that even the most basic chord choice becomes quite complicated. If you are writing music that just uses a few familiar chords, this might be fine. If you want to change key for musical effect or to match a singer's range, or explore exotic chord choices, you might have to completely retune or even rebuild your instrument. This generates an additional guiding principle. Number 4, we desire consistency between analogous intervals. In other words, we can try spacing the notes evenly. Not almost evenly, but exactly evenly. If we do that, the ratio between analogous intervals will be totally consistent, and guideline number 4 will be satisfied. We can ask what number of evenly spaced notes would best match all four guidelines. Well, 12 already had a strong case under guidelines 1 through 3, but adding the fourth guideline really seals the deal. Even though we have now spaced the notes only according to a strict division of the octave, it happens to line up remarkably closely to the simple ratios we like so much. There is a cost. With the exception of the octave, which is sacrosanct at a perfect 2-to-1 ratio, we no longer have the luxury of perfectly aligning the notes with any of the simple ratios. Any tonal system that uses an equal spacing of notes is said to be equally tempered, and 12-tone equal temperament is sometimes written as 12-tet, or 12-edo, for equal divisions of the octave. In case you're still skeptical about 12-tet, consider this visualization. Here are the octave notes. We extend them down the screen. Between them, we show the simple consonant ratios. Now, let's try out a variety of systems with different numbers of notes. We're trying to get as close as possible to these six consonant ratios. Let's start with a total of 7 notes. We can see that these 7 notes overlap the simple ratios poorly. Let's try 8, and 9, and so forth. We go on up the list, and 12 lines up remarkably well. It's not far from any of the simple ratios. There are other systems that are close. Consider 19. It does better on most of the ratios, but not on the important 4/3 and 3/2 intervals. It also uses a lot of tones that are not consonant, which violates guideline number 1. Even if you ignore extraneous dissonant intervals, it turns out that to beat the 12-tone scale on overall proximity to these simple ratios, you have to go up to 29 notes per octave. So we now see that 12-tet, and indeed any tonal system, involves compromise. The notes on a piano, being tuned to equal temperament, don't perfectly reproduce the simple ratios that our ears prefer, but they are close enough in most cases. And anyway, the variations of intonation and instruments often far outweigh the discrepancies in the tuning system. Most people, even most musicians, can't tell the difference between a true 3/2 interval and an equal-tempered fifth. With other intervals, the difference is more obvious, but in practice, it is not a terrible sacrifice. If you play violin in an orchestra, or sing chords in an a cappella group, or generate pure sine tones for your synthesized music, you might tweak your intonation every now and then to hit these ratios perfectly. If you're an adventurous composer, you might play with the effects that subtle pitch variation can have. As with all things in music theory, it's not instruction, it's insight. You can apply it as you see fit. Hopefully, this all makes it clear that the general 12-tone scale is certainly not arbitrary. I think it's also a strong case that 12-tet is a great choice when it comes to equally tempered systems. It's not a case against using other systems if you are so inspired, and it's certainly not an argument that one system is abstractly superior to any others or right for any particular cultural expression, but it is an argument that the 12-tone system makes good sense and meets the requirements enumerated here better than the alternatives. It's amazing to consider that an alien on a distant planet stands a respectable chance of using the same tonal system that many of us do. The more you study psychoacoustics, evolutionary biology, and the history of our musical systems, the more plausible it seems. Finally, a quick announcement. I'm creating a second channel where I will publish the kinds of videos I was traditionally creating here. And for now, I'll use this channel for educational videos. If you're a subscriber from the older days, or if you're interested in folky music recordings, geeky projects, and the like, head over to the second channel and subscribe there. I hope this video was useful to you. These videos do take weeks to produce, so if you have like 50 cents or $1 or $1,000 or $1 million, there's a link down there in the hoopty-hoo for donations. Thanks.